You're all pretty much fucked. And I hate to tell you this, but it's a bankrupt business model. It won't work. It's systemic, malignant, and it's global. Like cancer. It's a disease, and we gotta fight back.
We built our house here in 1981, and at that time, it was just a ragweed field. We planted everything around us here, including all those pine trees. And we enjoyed it for quite a while, with a peace and quiet, secondary road, nice sunrise at the time before they grew up, and a sunset before that grew up. We could see Syracuse from here. It was great. It was a great place to raise our children, and people are nice up here, and it's agriculture and very remote in a way. We liked that.
My name's John Yancey. I've lived here for 29 years, built on my family farmland, and The Maple Ridge project came about in 2005, 2006. It's drastically altered our scenery and our landscape. It's, as you will see, probably these towers are approximately just under 400 feet. They're what they call 80 meter tower, 40 meter blades. They stand 390 plus feet. They at times make quite a lot of noise, as you could probably today. They're fairly quiet. They're actually, some of them aren't even running. The ones that are running, I can pretty much guarantee they're not producing any power. People's myth think just because they're turning, they're running, they're actually pulling electricity off the grid. If they're not turning a 14.4 rotation on these Vestas 1.65s here that we have, they've proposed more in the area, and the Copenhagen wind project is up and running, and it's been up and running less than a year. I guess the storm damage here of last week took one of the blades completely off. So that's makes you wonder about the actual safety of these at a given time. I know in the winter time they throw big chunks of ice, and I've seen them. I've seen chunks of ice pretty near as big as a car hood laying in the snow.
What do you think of that?
Is it my understanding they're also going to be taller?
500 feet, 200 feet taller than this.
Oh my God.
And the blades will be 182 feet.
Oh my gosh. A sequoia wouldn't hold that, wouldn't hide that. Oh my God. No, 8 feet. It's too close. No, 900 feet is too close. And like I said about number 18, and I didn't mention it here, they had one blade shear off in February of 2016.
Crews working for NL Green Power spent much of the morning inspecting and later lifting up the 113-foot-long wind turbine blade that broke free yesterday off Bullier Road.
Under load, sheared. And that was the day when my wife and I were there. We were here when it happened, and it was a strong west wind. Typical February day like that, blowing snow. And that blade, I measured it. It impacted from the tower. The initial impact was 328 feet from the tower. And then the blade bounced another 148 feet. I got technical. I got right to the foot on this. It bounced another 148 feet before it came to rest, for a total of almost 500 feet. That's a big blade, and it bounced a long way. That's something that should be considered a 700 and some foot setback.
You talked about 1.25 miles as being kind of minimal. People are going 1.5 miles or greater, and that's so. Yeah, it's just too close. It's going to cause problems.
Well, it's too close. One of my last slide, I think, was showing that the impact of a neighbor at roughly 1,400 feet in Thelma from a 1.65 megawatt turbine.
How many? What rating are these?
3.2 megawatts. Okay. So, it's too close.
They're putting them way too close to people's houses. They've changed the setbacks, the noise levels aren't accurate. They need to live it. So I do, and I live it. So take my word of it. Absolutely, it's way too close. And if they're doing, my understanding, they're looking to lower the setbacks to 750. They are nuts.
And the thing is, Al, I would ask anybody that's proposing this is, what's wrong with putting them somewhere away from residents? There's plenty of places up here that they could have put these on property that didn't have a residence near it. And that, to me, would solve a lot of problems. What complaints would you get then?
What do you think the setback should be for you?
I think at least 2,500 foot is a reasonable setback. I have one that's 2,500 feet to my south, and that is can be heard, but it's not overbearing. Where this other one is, it hits you in the face when you walk out the front door, so to speak.
They are not quiet. They've ruined our evenings on the back deck. Not all the time, don't get me wrong. But when they are, they're not quiet. And depending on the weather conditions and the air density, I've noticed, the sound is different. And some evenings when I'll come outside to take the dogs outside, it sounds like I'm at an international airport. It is a jet engine sound when these things are going full speed. And now with the longer blades on them, I've noticed that it's a different type of noise that the blades produce, which I believe might be the something to do with the wind behind them. A vortex, maybe, if I'm using the right word. But whatever it is now, Al, is definitely louder. And it's a whole different noise than what we had before they changed the blades and lengthened them here. I used a small decibel meter, right, an app off my phone to see what the noise was one night. And it was in the mid to high 50s, 50 decibels.
Never did I dream that this would, they would be as annoying as they can be.
These turbines produce so many different noises with different atmospheric conditions. It's pretty amazing to listen to the different. Some are the whooping sound, like a blade, whop whop, like that, to describe it, and others are that. The jet engine sound, and still again, there's others that are just a grind. They are not silent. And anybody that tells you that they're silent doesn't. They either work for the windmill company or they want one on their property. Otherwise, the difficulties of dealing with the wind farm owners at this point. Now, that was a big issue. And when you have a problem, like I did with number 18 across the road, it took me a couple years, going almost 3 years, before, and trying to be a nice guy and deal with it on a one-on-one level with the maintenance over there about the noise that something was making. And we were more, I was told flat out after I tried doing it myself that, okay, go to the town board. And I did. And from that point on, when I had any difficulties, I will no longer talk to the maintenance folks down here. I'll go to the town board first, make a complaint. Although it goes against my grain, I would like to be friendly and personal and just say, hey, could you fix this? But they lied flat out about the situation. And then they finally told me, well, go see the town. That wasn't very good public relations.
And they told the town they were going to come out and measure the...
They did. They volunteered it at one meeting I had down there that they would set up a sound truck here, a sound system to record it. And I agreed, you can have my property to do whatever you want. And months down the road, over a year down the road, when I kept asking for this, I was finally told, and I've got the documentation inside, the names of the people that worked for NL, and in this case over here, Goldwyn, that no, cost too much money. We're not going to do it. There again, no cooperation.
I sleep with a air purifier next to the bed to run. It's basically a fan, a noise to keep a constant even noise so you can sleep. It ain't at first these windmills would, you know, they start and stop during the night and make noises, and you couldn't sleep with the bed windows open because you'd hear them start and stop, and they creak and make noises. So I found to keep my sanity and sleep, get my sleep, I've gotten used to sleeping with this extra constant noise where I am. And I think it could be a good thing. I just don't think the setbacks are right. I don't think the setbacks are, they're too close. They let them put them too close. I was able to negotiate getting a couple of the turbines moved here that would have been in my southern western domain, and I didn't I kind of overlooked this one that they had, and when it come apparent, it was too late. The shadow flicker on them is depending on how close you are. If you're close, you're going to get it substantially. I get some here. I have a pretty good tree growth in surroundings here. It isn't as bad as I've seen in my travels. When you get in between them and the sun, or you know, downstream of their rotation, with the sun coming up and setting, you have substantial shadow flicker. And there's been some studies and health issues on that. That can cause a range of problems from my understanding.
Does it actually happen to you?
I have shadow flicker on the house a little bit. It's a dim, it ain't a full blackout like as you would if you were closer. I see it on the tree line over here off the one that's presently here, it's substantial.
They were going to raise the assessment on my house, and this was within the whole town. It wasn't just me. And I made an appointment to go to the grievance. They wanted to increase my value by $36,000 here, and whatever that translated into taxes. At the grievance, they had similar properties that they showed me pictures of that were supposed to be similar for tax purposes, that this is this property, it's taxed for this and that. And after they showed that to me, I agreed with them, except I said there's one thing these other properties lack that I have. And when they asked me, I told them it was a wind turbine 900 feet behind their house. And they closed the books. And then they said, Mr. Forringer, you're right. With the new tax adjustments, your taxes will actually go down. This was an assessment. And apparently they did agree with me that wind turbine affects the property value. It would seem to me, the question I would ask somebody in with the turbines that are being proposed for you is, could I sell my property for what it's worth? If I was to have those similar properties that they showed to me for sale, would I be able to get the same for mine with the turbines around me? In all, there's six that are within, I think, about 1,600 feet. Directly across from us here is number 15. That's 900 feet. But any homeowner should be asking, what's my property value going to be worth once these are up? If I want to sell it, am I going to get what it's worth?
I'd like to see a recorded sale here that somebody has actually sold their place and benefited what they should from it. I can't picture it helping your sale of your property in any way, shape, or form.
Can we sit here as a company and say that some property value around the project is not going to be affected, or no property value? No. And to your point, sir, I cannot say whether or not a home value in a project area, I won't sit here and say that no home value in a project area would be adversely affected, because certainly someone's desire to move into an area could be adversely affected by that.
I sold a farm that was 100 acres in Orangeville, and according to what I got for it, I believe that I lost around $100,000 on that farm.
I lost $120,000 on my home, which sat on the market for years, and couldn't get a buyer for it.
In the beginning, when they first came around, I thought that the possibilities could be good for the area and the area, but after experiencing and seeing it, I'm not thinking it's the same anymore. It's and my first wife, we had problems because we fought about the noise and the problems, and I think it was a little bit of an issue and conflict between us why that didn't work out. So I don't think they can help in family relationships that where people have different opinions on that stuff.
She's kind of given up on going to the town meetings. She doesn't feel that we're being represented fairly, and she's starting to feel that she's powerless to change what's going on. I, on the other hand, I still say I was here first. I built my house here, and now Fenner Planning Board decided that these were the best things for town of Fenner, and here we are. Now, if I could add one thing, this is the worst part, that I got a bad taste in my mouth, because myself and a few others that are still here that owned their homes before this farm was built, I feel that the whole of town of Fenner benefited from these wind generators tax-wise, but my family, we suffered the consequences. I mean, most of town of Fenner lives nowhere near these. They don't have to deal with the towers and the noise. And well, the traffic's diminished now over the years, but that used to be quite a bit. They don't have to deal with the flicker effect, and they enjoy the benefits of the tax breaks, whereas we get the dirty end of the stick.
I'm gonna think there ain't gonna be much more than a handful, if that. And I don't know how many thousands of acres these encompass, this project, but I think you'll find that it's gonna be pretty minimal. I think you're gonna see that elsewhere too. In my personal opinion, I think they need to invest their time and energies into other sources of energy. Money is a big factor in how they get their foot in the door. Martinsburg had a meager town budget, and they literally, a year or two after they got the money rolling in, they they doubled their town budget.
I mean, up here in Fenner, our taxes are 99% road maintenance. That's a hard job, and I understand these guys are doing their best, but with the heavy equipment that these have to have for maintenance and whatever, they tear the roads up. But anytime they have to fix a blade, keep this in mind, or a turbine, the equipment that has to come to reach that high, if you have a problem with a blade, that has to come over your roads with super heavy weight, these things are, and to do the work. So the initial setup of any turbines or a wind farm like this, where they agree to fix the roads afterwards, that's not included down the line here, where they need, where it tears it up years later. They're not subject to pay for that, which drives our town's maintenance fellow, Danny there, drives him nuts. Like I said, my only advice, if you're a homeowner and your property's there, you were there first, and you should have a voice in this, a large voice. But unfortunately, in this case here, the town planning board approves it. There's no vote involved.
A lot of the town board people, that if you aren't affected, you know, you don't understand it. But if you're affected by it, it becomes quite a deal. So they, I don't think they always represent the people in the town really well. I think they're representing the town, and they see that dollar, and you know, the dollar makes the world go round. It's unfortunate that it happens like that, but I don't like it. Well, I think a lot of people from outside the area passing through, you know, oh, look at the windmills. They look majestic. They look cute, you know. But then after a while, you know, it's like, you know, there they are, you know, it's taking up your scenery and your sunsets, and you get shadow flicker on them and the sunrises and sunsets. A person can live with anything. I'm sure, you know, do you want to live that way?
The bad part about the, with the wind farm is aesthetically, you're going to lose your charm, like we did up here in Fenner. If you did put yourself in that situation on your property where you were to enjoy what you had, and all of a sudden you're surrounded by windmills making noise every day, much less in the evening, the clearance lights they have on them, navigation lights, you're surrounded by them. So to be able to sit outside and enjoy the stars early, you know, and maybe have a small campfire like we do usually out here and sit and listen when the coyotes start, that's gone, because you got these red clearance lights blinking all around you all night long, and you might as well live down near the city. Took away what we had up here.
I do not receive any benefits or royalties from these wind towers at this. They try to get people to pit one neighbor against another when they build them, and they have what they call basically a gag order, in layman's term, to keep people quiet. They sign for some cash, and yearly cash, I believe, and they. Life goes on, I guess. Some of the contracts they make you sign or want you to sign or whatever are absurd. It's big business.
For us, there's nothing.
Why shouldn't they be taxed? My house sits on a footprint of a certain scale, and they don't lower my taxes ever. They never lowered my taxes. I don't see how they should get a free ride, and the homeowner is going to pay through the nose because of these here. That let's just give them more money, more tax credits. They give them big credits when they build them, like the first year, 40% is my understanding, and then. As this project has been, I think, sold a couple times, they get that 40% again. So they wrote these turbines off. Big money's wrote these off. My big question is, and I don't know how, I don't know all the tax situations, all the tax law. My home, if I sell it, I have to pay 1%, or whoever buys it has to pay 1% in a real estate tax, okay? So let's say it's $200,000. So they'd have to pay $2,000. These sell for millions. How much money is that's left on the table or not paid for real estate tax when they're sold? You know, that's where I kind of, the county wouldn't be wanting for no money if they paid what they're selling these projects for. The work, people work here, a lot of people commute to Watertown, Fort Drum, which I am a little puzzled why they're targeting this area with more wind, because as we know, Fort Drum is a huge employer, a huge contributor to the economy.
I'm H. Wayne Wilson at the National Weather Service in Lincoln, Illinois. When wind farms were first proposed, there was a lot of discussion about the impact it would have on the environment and the migration of birds. But one issue that wasn't discussed at length was the impact it would have on predicting the weather.
When they actually started in operation, then that's when we saw the scope of the situation. You zoom in on there, you really see the intensity of those. That is where we are getting the reflection off the wind farm.
Why would they even run the risk of jeopardizing all them jobs and all them people with all of the way base closures are and the way they shut things down militarily, why would you even put turbines in an area that could jeopardize government jobs that are the backbone of a lot of things here?
We were given a contract, an agreement that they had written up that said if we could not get a fair market value for our home within 3 years, they would make up the difference, but for 3 years. So we took the contract to our lawyer, had him read it, and he agreed that it was a sound deal, and we signed it, agreed to it, called up the man in charge, I don't know, should I say names? Atlantic Renewable Energy was responsible in the beginning for building these, and the person in charge at that time was Bill Moore. And my wife repeatedly called him to come and get this contract. It's done, it's signed. And without even having the courtesy of a return call, never came back. Never showed up, never wanted the contract, and we still have it in there, signed, ready to go, and they just turned their backs on us. It was a decoy. So, here on down the road, 3 years is a pretty short time to be able to get your market value. But here we are now, 19 years later, 18, and if you want to sell your house, there's no agreement that they're going to help you. I suppose a person could hire a lawyer and you could go to court to try to get some type of a settlement on it. Personally, I'm not built that way.
But why should you have to?
Exactly. But further on down the line, I'm afraid that that's what it's going to come to. And like I said, my only advice, if you're a homeowner, and your property's there, you were there first. And you should have a voice in this, a large voice. But unfortunately, in this case here, the town planning board approves it. There's no vote involved. What you're doing right now is a good idea. It's an excellent idea to talk to people that have lived amongst them and get their feedback. Now, don't just take somebody like my word. I'm negative because I've never had any positive reactions with them. And I would speak positively if there was. So I would suggest to the homeowners to be involved. Take a look around you. Go to other wind farms. Drive up as close as you can get when they're working on a day that you can hear.
The one thing that we know renewables do is raise the cost of electricity, and that of course hurts lower income folks. On the other hand, it's not going to do anything for the climate. There are 2,400 coal-fired power plants in planning or being constructed across the world right now. China's constructing 1,000, India's constructing 400, even Japan's building 45. What you do in New York State isn't going to have any effect on global temperatures, but it's going to raise energy prices for New York citizens.
Greed, for lack of a better word, is good.
But we took an important step tonight by passing a resolution limiting the pilot programs from the Chautauqua IDA to 5 megawatts and smaller. What this does, basically, we will grant pilots to those small projects for residential homes, but these large turbine projects will no longer be receiving pilot monies from this county to support those projects.
There's always strength in numbers, and you know, just like us, you know, we looked to other counties to see what they had done, and I hope now that other counties throughout New York State will look at Chautauqua County and say, well, you know, they did it, now it's our turn, and I think we can beat back this thing as a whole, because I look at that map with all of these proposed projects, and again, for projects that don't deliver at all on the promises that they make, we're going to destroy our landscape upstate for what is essentially a political agenda, a profit investment scam is all it is, and I hope that other communities band together throughout upstate New York, and that we beat back this this tragedy from occurring in New York State and destroying the beautiful pristine area that we enjoy up here in upstate New York.
The 50 by 30 program is unrealistic for a number of reasons. First and foremost, in order to have 50% of our electricity come from renewable energy, that might be possible in a smaller state like, you know, Kansas or Wyoming, but New York State is one of the largest users of electricity in the world, and New York City in particular. So to do that, you're going to have to blanket all of upstate New York with windmills and solar panels. And that is just devastating to, you know, one of the main assets that we have here, which is the pristine beauty of our outdoors. That's what separates us from New York City. So I think it's unrealistic, and on top of that, going to be extremely expensive to taxpayers, because wind energy is not self-sustaining. It will have to be subsidized. And to do 50% of the large demand that New York State has for electricity in a subsidy format is going to cost billions perpetually to the taxpayers.
Wind and solar power have the effect of increasing rather than decreasing the emissions of conventional pollutants and greenhouse gases, because they're so unreliable, they have to be backed up with conventional either coal or gas-fired power plants, and those have to be cycled up and down depending on whether on wind and sunlight conditions. And the cycling of those plants means they have to be run inefficiently, which increases their emissions.
Windmills do not happen. They're not built without massive and ongoing government subsidies. You need federal green credits to build them, and you need what's referred to as offtake agreements or power purchase agreements with organizations, typically government organizations like NYSERDA, where they are agreeing to buy electricity at above market prices and then turning around and selling it on the open market at a loss. Well, who's covering that loss? We are, the taxpayers. And it's totally unnecessary to come in and tear apart communities, tear apart the landscape, have a negative impact on people's health, have a negative impact on people's quality of life and on their property values. For what? So that we can throw away taxpayer money in the process. It's just a totally useless process that should be eliminated.
And it's just a few people that are going to make money off of this, and there's not going to be a return for people that are going to suffer the consequences of these wind farms.
Well, I don't. Yeah, Governor Cuomo is nice if he likes him so much. And there's lots of wind everywhere. You know, I'd like to see one in his backyard too, you know, if he likes them so much, you know. Why don't they keep them closer to the metropolitan areas where they can use electricity more fluently and easily and less distribution and stuff? They don't seem to do that. They target the small populated areas. They thrive off that because there's minimal opposition. If that's the case, then that should tell you something there already. If a number of people are opposed to them, then it isn't necessarily a good thing.
have a windmill anywhere near your house, congratulations. Your house just went down 75% in value. And they say the noise causes cancer. You tell me that one. You know, the thing makes it so... And of course, it's like a graveyard for birds. If you love birds, you'd never want to walk under a windmill because it's a very sad, sad sight. It's like a cemetery.
The idea with TerraPower is that instead of burning the part of uranium, the 1%, which is the U-235, we decided, well, let's burn the 99%, the U-238. And because you're burning that 99%, you have a greatly improved cost profile. You actually burn up the waste, and you can actually use as fuel all the leftover waste from today's reactors. This is the leftover, the 99%, where they've taken out the part they burn now, so it's called depleted uranium. That would power the U.S. for hundreds of years. And simply by filtering seawater in an inexpensive process, you'd have enough fuel for the entire lifetime of the rest of the planet. But it is an example of the many hundreds and hundreds of ideas that we need to move forward.
My name is Brad Jones, and my wife and I, Linda, live in Naples, New York. I did work on the town board as a town supervisor a few years ago. I'm also now a member of the town planning board. That's in the town of Italy, New York. Yeah, a number of years ago, we reached out to the Office of Public Integrity at the Attorney General's office in New York City. And so we were able to explain to them, just over the telephone, some of the issues that we've seen where planning boards and town board members were given a number of incentives to allow these developers to come in. Sometimes the incentives were just cash payments. Sometimes the incentives were new cars for people on one planning board. All of them got new cars. And some of the incentives also were enhanced leases for landowners. And in many cases, there's a strong correlation between the large landowners being on town boards. So while I might have been able to get $3,000 for a lease for a turbine on my property, somebody else who's part of the game might get $15,000 or $20,000 or $25,000 for each turbine. So those were conversations we had with people at the Office of Public Integrity. And they began asking us more and more questions, and we began to send them documentation. Within 3 months, we actually had an on-site meeting with them where two assistant attorney generals and a state investigator came to the house. And we had people here for them to interview who were witnesses to these various aspects of corruption. Bribery in terms of cash, enhanced leases, and other incentives such as brand new cars. So here we now have the Attorney General's office providing three people on what was going to be a full-time investigation. Both Sally Blinken from Manhattan and Andy Hefner out of Syracuse began to apply themselves full-time in digging into this issue. They found it was pretty tough because a lot of these landowners and a lot of these board members simply wouldn't talk. And so they continued the investigation and continued to then also find the exact same types of activity, same types of things happening in three different towns up along the St. Lawrence, and then in other towns and other counties, including down in Cattaraugus County. So they were beginning to see this pattern, and they simply began to continue to listen and to open up their lines of communication so that any town in the state that, and I think there were 35 or 37 towns that were being proposed for turbines at the time, they had an open line to the Attorney General's office, and they took this very, very seriously. Then we saw that the investigator disappeared. He was no longer being involved. Then Sally Blinken was moved. They moved her over to, I think it was Medicaid Fraud Bureau. And Andy Hefner was the only one left, still working with us, trying to keep the wind turbines out of our towns and villages. At that point, Andy was told by his boss, Cuomo, that he was no longer able to interview any public officials. And then he went on to say, also, you can't interview anyone else outside of the Syracuse office. That meant that Andy could no longer continue the investigation. He was being stopped because it wasn't politically popular to oppose industrial wind turbines in the state. But I mean, it was pretty obvious, because the next thing that they did was they reduced Andy's job description to one thing. His job was reduced to simply processing certificates of compliance that the wind developers would send into his office. That was the extent of his job. Well, after they made that change late one year, he called me just after Christmas and said, I have to leave. I am getting nothing done. I spent 25 years as a prosecutor in New York City, and I felt good about every day that I went to work. For the last year and a half, I haven't been able to deliver anything for the people of the state of New York. So I'm changing careers, and I'll let you know how I do.
Andrew Cuomo and Carl Paladino to end corruption is like asking an arsonist to help us put out the fires.
Governor Cuomo has no intention of rooting out corruption. He lives and breathes corruption in New York. Thank you.